I want to start with President Trump's rally over the weekend. Obviously, attendance wasn't quite what the White House had been planning for. And now there's reporting that perhaps teenagers on TikTok reserved all these seats, then didn't show. What's your take on this?
When we were campaigning, we were always trying to estimate how many people were going to show up to events. And a lot of it was based on sign-up. So I think those teens were very smart. I think that is what happened, is that they boosted the numbers to some inflated level. And then the true level was some fraction of that. So it just goes to show that, if you're going to run an event, you have to try and figure out who's signing up, where they live, and whether they're going to show.
Normally, it's President Trump that is expertly using the power of social media. On that note, do you think that the Biden campaign understands technology enough and can do what they need to do in order to break through, hold on to the momentum that they have, and generate the buzz that is going to be needed to win?
I think Joe is going to do well among many, many Americans because people know him so well. I do think it's going to be difficult for him to somehow catch up to President Trump in terms of his subscriber count or his social media following. So he should lean on people that already have pre-existing followings to try and amplify his message online. But Americans get their information from many different sources. And I believe Joe is poised to compete and win in the fall, even if his YouTube subscriber count doesn't quite catch up to President Trump's.
What do you think Biden needs to do in order to continue to gain momentum? Obviously, at a time when we're in the middle of a pandemic, you can't have in-person rallies generally. How does he break through?
Now, what's interesting is that I feel like this current landscape actually is favoring Joe, because the more we see of Trump, the worse he seems. And Joe is just rising steadily because we all are familiar with him. I think the Biden campaign should keep reaching out to people in different quarters, because the fact is, if Joe reaches out to you and says, hey, will you work with me on this? Most everyone will say yes, because many people are very eager to see Trump out of the White House in the fall.
Now, you've been very busy since you left the campaign, and now you are announcing your own initiative to get people compensated for their data. Obviously, companies like Facebook, Google, Twitter, they make a lot of money on data that's created by their users. How exactly would this work? You know, what would the nuts and bolts be?
Well, California just passed a law earlier this year, the CCPA, that gives consumers these data property rights that they did not have before. And so my new initiative, DDP, Data Divident Project, is going to serve as a union for many consumers to negotiate with tech companies on our collective behalf. Because like you just said, you have Facebook, Google, these other companies that are profiting to the tune of tens of billions of dollars per year off of our data. And if anyone should be paid for the use of our data, we should be included.
Well, what's been the reaction from lawmakers here? I mean, obviously we have this privacy law in California, but there's federal legislation potentially pending that still hasn't happened on data privacy.
California took the lead. Nevada followed California's lead, has a law very similar to CCPA. Washington, New York, and other states are looking to follow suit. So we shouldn't necessarily wait for Congress. We can actually go in a state-by-state level, particularly because California already has a law on the books that's going to be enforced starting next week.
Now, you championed many progressive ideas during your campaign, including universal basic income. We're seeing Biden's policy and economic team coming together, and it is more centrist. What's your take on that? Given that some of the ideas that you championed haven't seemed to take off within the Democratic Party.
There are now dozens of legislators who are actually championing emergency cash relief during the pandemic throughout the entire crisis. And we know this is going to extend for months and years. So I'm optimistic that Joe and his team are open-minded about different solutions to help us get out of this deep, dark hole we're in. The reality is tens of millions of jobs are gone for good. 40% are not going to come back, which would still leave us in a hole something like two times as deep and dark as the Great Recession, which took us years to recover from. When I talk to Joe and his team, they're open-minded about different types of solutions. I think they'll consider universal basic income and many other things.
So how often do you talk to his team? And is it to the point that if he won, you think you might have a job in the administration?
Well, our teams are in touch. I talked to Joe personally a number of weeks ago on his podcast. He's supposed to come on mine too, which would be a lot of fun. But our teams are in regular contact. I try not to bombard Joe myself, because I know what it's like to be the candidate. You know, you have a lot on your plate, particularly in his case, because we're all relying upon him to win in the fall.
So at this point, we're in a pandemic. We've got protests around racial injustice happening across the country. So not just a health crisis, but an economic crisis and a social crisis. How does that all play into who he should pick as his VP? Who do you think it should be?
Well, you hit the nail on the head that we're in the midst of what someone called the omni crisis, where it's like you have crises compounding on each other. And I don't have any inside info, but I know that California's Kamala Harris is one of the front runners. To me, a lot of it is about Joe's chemistry with the person, because he's going to have to govern with that person for 4 or even more years. And he knows that chemistry better than anyone, having served as VP himself. So it has to be an individual decision for Joe.
You sued to restore the New York primary. Why did you do that? Are you trying to gain some leverage which would enable you to write some of the party's platform?
I thought it was a terrible precedent to just do away with the primary. You have mail-in voting. You have the capacity for people to vote safely. It just was going to set a terrible precedent that, say, you can do away with an election if you decide that that's what you want to do. And the federal court saw it the same way, said, look, you can't deprive people of their right to vote this way. So I'm really glad that the law and democracy prevailed and the people of New York can vote tomorrow at the presidential level as well as the local level.
But is that your hope of gaining some sort of leverage to be more involved in potentially developing the platform? And have you talked to the Sanders team about that as well?
I'm hopeful that the platform will evolve to include universal basic income and some of the other things that I championed. You know, I just saw, Emily, there's a poll that said something like 75% of Americans agree with emergency cash relief for everyone during this crisis. The Democrats need to embrace that policy, because it's a winning recipe right now, given how many Americans are suffering.